So we're starting with the last page first. So husbandry is just how well you guys are cleaning, which I know seems kind of trivial, but it's actually super duper important. It prevents several different things like bacterial infections. We're all very familiar with kind of cough because we see it all the time and the vaccines for it. There's also certain viral infections that are easily transmitted, and intestinal parasites is another really big one that is very easily spread and relatively easily preventable by deworming and preventative, and the most important part, good cleaning. Our dogs here, of course, are all vaccinated, so that means why we're here so much, because if they had the vaccine, then they should be protected, it shouldn't really matter as much. But when dogs come here, even though they love it here, it is still somewhat stressful for them, and whenever a dog is stressed out, has a change of environment, they are slightly immunosuppressed. So as a result, they're going to be more prone to picking up infections. There are also a number of different, like the viral infections and bacterial infections, they come in different strains. It's not always the same strain that causes the same infection. So kennel cough, for example, is oftentimes bacteria, but it can also be a virus. And there's different strains involved in viruses. Our vaccines, of course, we're trying to get the most common ones, but there are still some that are not covered. So for those ones that are kind of slipping through the cracks are the part why the hygiene is so important. There's also, most of these types of infections have an incubation period. So kennel cough, for example, the incubation period is 3 to 10 days. So for example, if we get a dog in that we're vaccinating for kennel cough the day it gets here, if it was exposed to kennel cough 3 days ago, it may not be showing any symptoms, but yet it still has the infection, it's still carrying it, and it's still able to transmit it. So when it gets here, even though we never see a symptom from that dog, it's still sharing those germs with all the dogs that it's in contact with. And that's even in a vaccinated dog. So that's another reason why cleaning is so important. The intestinal parasites are another really big one. That's probably the hardest of them all to really keep in check, because a big part of the intestinal parasite prevention comes from the owner. But since not all owners are getting their heartworm prevention regularly, that's why the hygiene part becomes so important, to try and keep it all in check. Intestinal parasites are transmitted through a number of different ways. Most commonly through ingestion, fecal matter. But those eggs that are in the feces will also get in the soil. So the dogs can be out playing in the soil and ingesting those eggs as they're out running around. They can also get those eggs on their fur. So when they're out rolling around in the sand, those eggs are getting on them. And when they go clean themselves, they're ingesting those eggs off of their own body. And contaminated water, they can get the eggs in there as well. And the dogs go drink the water. So picking up the poop is super important, because that's the primary source of those eggs. If you know you have a problem too, bathing the dogs is going to get the eggs off of their coat, so it's harder for it to get ingested off of their coat. And then cleaning the kennels thoroughly, of course, too, to get those eggs out of the environment. So when you get the next dog in there, they're not going to pick up those eggs. So when we're talking about hygiene, another thing to think about is there's other areas, not just the kennels, that are getting exposed to pathogens as well. So the dogs that are coming in for grooming, in theory, you should be cleaning off the grooming table in between every dog. Because those, you know, when you groom one dog, you're getting all those germs, any eggs that are on their coat, any bacterial viral spores are getting in the environment, then you groom your next dog and you're sharing all that stuff. So grooming tables are an important one. Bathtubs, I know, is probably tricky because you guys bathe a lot of dogs. In an ideal world, the bathtubs should, every time you give a dog a bath, you should be cleaning that tub before you give the next dog a bath. And then the front desk area is where you don't think about as much because there's not quite as much traffic there. But dog dander can travel far. So even like your computer surfaces, where you guys are working, you are getting eggs on you when you touch the dog, when you go to your computer, you start working on your computer, and now that's in that environment, and you come on and touch the next dog. So those are just kind of the less common places that you think about trying to keep track of cleaning. That are also important as well. So of course, cleaning is a pain in the butt and takes a long time. So there's no way you're going to be able to clean every single surface perfectly at all times. So you just have to do the best you can. Keep all of those principles in the back of your mind. Try to clean as much as you can and stay on top of it. But no matter what, you know, the dogs do have immune systems that are supposed to help protect them. So the ultimate goal is to just keep the pathogens low enough and the immune system strong enough that they even out and keep everything from exploding on you. So the next topic is float. This is a common, not super common, but relatively common thing that dogs can get. Its fancy name for float is called gastric dilatation convolvulus, and it's actually self-explanatory about what it is. So, what happens is the stomach, which is the gastric part of that word, dilates and twists, which is the dilation involved with this. When that happens, the ingesta, or the food or water that they have inhaled, gets trapped in the stomach and can't get out. When that happens, then there's this whole cascade of additional things that follow that are bad. So, the blood supply that's going to the stomach, as the stomach is twisting, that blood supply is not getting to the stomach anymore. Whenever you have lack of blood supply, that leads to tissue death. So that's the necrosis part up there. Gastric ulceration also is like if you get a stomach ulcer because they're not getting the blood supply, the acid stuff's not getting out, acid is building up, and the tissue again starts to ulcerate. Secondary effects, because there's problems in the stomach, they start to have respiratory distress, they'll have cardiac distress, so they're having difficulty breathing, they're having difficulty pumping blood. As the stomach is getting bigger and bigger, it's going to push all the other organs in its body out of place, so all the other organs get repositioned. Eventually, the vessels are not going to work anymore, blood's not going where it needs to go, the stomach can eventually pop and rupture. Which then causes all the contents to spill into the rest of the abdomen, which causes sepsis, which is just a big, generalized, really bad bacterial infection. And then finally, you do get death. So bloat is a very serious condition that you don't want to ignore. We're getting there. So it is most common in large-breed dogs. It is not guaranteed to just affect large breed dogs. It can affect any dog, but it's more of a problem for large breed dogs. Those are just the most common ones that you would expect to see it in. It can affect any age dog, so it doesn't matter if it's a puppy versus a really old dog. They're both equally affected. Gender doesn't make a difference either. Males, females, also equally affected. The most predisposing characteristic is if they're deep chested. So that's why those large breed dogs that have that really deep chest are more prone to get it. And this is, there's no really exact reason why some dogs get it and some don't, but these are some of the risk factors that make it easier. So if they're eating a large volume of food or water and they ingest it really quickly, they go out, run around outside, that can predispose to it. Dry food, in certain studies, has shown they're more prone to get it with dry food. So if an owner tells you this dog has bloated before, you may want to ask them, is it okay to wet their food? And then aerophagia, which is just swallowing of air, some dogs just do that when they get excited. And that can also predispose them to bloat. Symptoms would be the side effects of any of those things that we were talking about earlier. So a big one is you'll see them trying to vomit, but nothing's coming up. So they're just retching and nothing's happening. You can actually physically see the distended abdomen a lot of times too. This isn't a great picture, but you can see his abdomen is actually bigger. So if you notice, you're looking at a dog.
were going to do it with CPR anyway.
So. Oh, you're going to check it on CPR? Okay.
So you'll see how to do that, but there's a place in their back leg that you can just kind of feel, and you'll be able to feel their pulse. If it feels like it's really rapid and weak and thready, that would be for you to alert you, and we're going to be talking about that more properly with both heat stroke and CPR stuff. The mucous membranes are their gums, so you can pick up their lip if they look like their gums are really white and pale. That's a big red flag. The capillary refill time, if you touch their gums, you'll see the gum turn white, and then it should turn pink right as soon as you let go. If it is prolonged, then it's gonna, you're going to push on the gum, and it's not going to turn pink again right away. It's going to stay white for a little bit. And then, of course, they're having difficulty breathing, so they're panting. They've got really shallow breaths. So if you notice any of these symptoms, and you know that it's a high-risk dog, it's a big, deep-chested dog, it's doing all this weird stuff, it is an emergency that you want to get someone immediately. So if we're here, you want to come over to us. It is something that's diagnosed with x-rays, so we would have to get them over to the other office so that we could get an x-ray to confirm it and start treatment. If we're not here, don't wait for us. I would take it to the emergency clinic if we're closed and you can't get a hold of us. But it's something, the sooner that you can get it treated and diagnosed, the better. Because, like I said, death is the ultimate outcome of bloat. But not to scare you, it's not the most common thing in the world, but it's something to be aware of. So if you do see those symptoms, don't ignore it.
And this is one that y'all go straight to your supervisor and have the supervisor contact the owner, contact the wall. If you do not need to contact me, this is what you're saying. Because I can't do anything over the phone with this or even get there in time, I would tell you to call the emergency. The owner's your first call, the ER is your second. So this particular thing is not something that I can do. Get here in time to call you.
Any questions on anything up to this point? Which is basically it's hyperthermia. Body temperature gets elevated. Here in Florida, we probably see more heat strokes than pretty much another state. Southwest, Southern California, Texas, yeah, they have two, but we stay hot pretty much year round. And there are multiple cases that we see all the time. I mean, it can happen very quickly. I don't know if anyone has seen this, or I think we just had one a couple of weeks ago.
That was that.
But that was a minor case where we won't get into all that. But basically, a dog's temperature, anywhere from about 100 degrees up to 102, 102.5 is their normal range. Anything above 103, we actually consider hyperthermic or abnormal. 103, usually we don't have to worry too much about that. Unless you start approaching 104 and above, that's when we start getting concerned. Now, obviously, there's many different things that can cause an increase in temperature other than heat stroke. Yeah, they can have reactions, allergic reactions. They can be exercising, and body temperature goes up. They can have infections, disease processes, all that can add to your temperature. But when they're outside, here in Florida, it does not take long at all. So if you look at here, there's a bunch of different causes on here. I can go over a couple of them, but I don't need to do the whole list for you because I'm assuming you know how to read, or you're probably not going to be having your job right. But so confinement to areas. If you like here, we have lots of grass, we have sand, dirt, we've got water, things like that. You don't have cement or asphalt enclosures only, which you get a lot of heat from that. You don't want that. Don't keep them in cars. If you have an owner that comes in. Say, oh, I got poo-poo just sitting out in the car, but the windows are cracked. That's still, I don't know if any of you sat in the car out here in the summertime with your windows cracked. but that just doesn't go over very well. It heats up very quickly and does the same thing for them. They do not dissipate heat like we do. We have sweat going in, we have local things that help us stay cool. Dogs don't sweat, at least they don't sweat very much. They do have some sweat glands on their paws, and they sweat a little bit, but they mainly will pant to get rid of their heat. So, no cars, a lot of exercise outside in that hot weather. That can cause it as well. No shaded areas, all those kind of things is what you want to try to avoid and look out for when it comes to the summertime especially. Here is not too bad. Most of the animals, they can jump in the water, they have shaded areas, so they can go out for some time, but you still probably want to be mindful when it's the hottest part of the days to really keep an eye on all the animals. So obviously preventions of heat stroke is going to be things like make sure there's shaded areas, make sure they have fresh, clean water, making sure that they are outside for extended period of time and running around like crazy animals, things like that. Now when it comes to certain animals do have, certain animals are predisposed to heat stroke. So there is multiple things that can happen. I know people have bulldogs and stuff that here, so you guys have them. They have those smushed faces. So bulldogs, Boston Terriers, anything with that smashed face are going to be predisposed. They just don't breathe very well already, so they can't really get rid of their heat like other animals. Animals that have a clinical issue, such as laryngeal paralysis, which is basically that part of their throat's not opening, frozen like it should when they breathe. It actually stays a little bit more close. They don't breathe very well. So, once again, they're going to have to deal with this. Smaller dogs are collapsing trachea. I don't know if anyone has ever heard a dog that would cough, sounds like a goose, but that is a sign of collapsing trachea. Those animals, once again, should not be outside for a very long period of time. Matter of fact, I put on there that if there's an animal with a predisposing condition like that, they should probably only be outside when it's warm, no more than 5 or 10 minutes at a time, especially if they're active. Because it does not take long for them to go to bed at all. Any questions so far? So, there's a long list of clinical signs as well of heat stroke. Obviously, a rectal temperature would be one that is the most useful, but you can see this start to happen before you even take a temperature. Do you guys have rectal thermometers on your side? You might just want to do a couple just to have in case, especially if we're not here. But
they don't have to be fancy either.
Yeah,
they don't.
Yes, the $2 little Walgreens is fine. They get restless. They get agitated. They will pant excessively. They can get brick red gums. These are normal pink gums right here. They will be brick red using the heat stroke. They can, they will foam at the mouth. They can have vomiting. They can have diarrhea. So all these are also symptoms of many other diseases. So you really have to just figure out what's going on with the situation. You know, say, oh, what kind of dog is this? Are we really young? Are we really old? Do we have any medical issues? Things like that. And then just watch them. But if you're seeing these and they're outside, obviously get them inside as quick as possible. To start figuring out what's going on. But they can get disoriented, confusion, just sort of wander around. They may just lay down on the ground and not want to get up, and just sit there panting as well. And then in the severe cases, when it's been going on for a while, of course, there's things like coma, seizures, and death from heat stroke. The treatment of heat stroke, which is our next section, basically, like I said, if you're noticing any of these signs or symptoms and you're worried, go ahead, get the animal, bring it inside. You guys have air conditioning, so that's great, so you don't have to worry about anything else. Get them inside. Get a rectal temperature. You're going to want to take that temperature about every 15 minutes if you're above the 104. And that's when we start to do some cooling processes if we're above 104. If they're less than that, doing the panting and agitated, you can probably just keep an eye on them. Get a little fan, you can put a little fan on them, that's fine. Keep them inside, let them relax, and monitor that temperature just to see what happens and make sure it's coming down. But you're going to go ahead, you're going to start with that. As far as cooling goes, a lot of people, we get this all the time, I think my dog has heat stroke, I put him in an ice bath to cool them off. this is the number one thing you do not want to do when you're pulling them off. If you're really hot and then you get really cold, a couple things. One, your bike will go into shock. Two, it's going to take all those vessels that are going to the extremities and it's going to close them down, constrict them, and basically that's going to decrease blood flow, which is bad for your tissues, and it won't let the heat dissipate like normal when they're nice and open. So water is fine, but it should be cool water. You can spray them down with cool water from a hose. You can get a towel, get some cool water on it, and wrap them in a towel. That is fine. Other things you can use, isopropyl rubbing alcohol, basically. You can wet the pads, you can do their armpits, you can do their elbow area, you can even go underneath their neck where they're carotid and their jugular and everything else is flowing blood flow. So you can put that there. All the time, monitoring that temperature. That's gotta be key because you can't cool them too rapidly. And when they get to back down to that 103 degree mark, that's when you stop your cooling processes. Because at that point now we're in more of a safe zone and you don't want them to cool because some actually will go and keep going and they become hypothermic instead of hypothermic. But so that's when you stop at 103. Still monitor the temperature after that. You don't have to be as relentless. But at that point, if we're not here, obviously we'd have been involved in all these steps up to this point if we're here. If we're not here, once we get down to that 103, that's when you transport them to the emergency facility, kind of thing. Because they usually will still want to do IV catheters and other things, make sure that we're doing okay. They're definitely going to be monitored because having a heat stroke is a shock to the system. You can get all sorts of tissue damage. The GI tract tends to like to slough off and end up getting diarrhea everywhere. They can get body disorders because their body goes into a hyperclot mode in the hypothermia and uses up all their clotting factors, and then they tend to bleed all over the place. So things to look for in those cases would be little bruises on the gums, mucous membranes, the lips. They can show up on the abdomen, anywhere where you can really see skin. But it usually starts out on the mucous membranes, gums, lips, that kind of stuff first. But that is something you probably won't have to deal with, hopefully, because by that point they should be at the emergency facility. Any questions on this thus far? Okay. I guess we will move on to what to do when an animal's unresponsive, has no heartbeat, that kind of thing. Obviously, this is a bad situation for everybody involved. And I want to let you know that even us as professionals, when we do CPR, not a lot of them come back from that. So don't expect miracles. It's not like TV where they have like a 95% CPR success rate. It's probably more like a 5% CPR success rate in the real world. But things that you'll want to do, I'm glad you're right here, Cam. I know.
Just in case we do well for these.
I know. Basically, wherever the animal is, if it looks like it's non-responsive, basically they'll be laying there. Sometimes they'll have what we call agonal breaths, which looks like they're gasping for air. You just sort of do this kind of thing. So what you do first is amp them like that. You'll want to put them on their right side because the way the heart is, using the left side is going to be less.
Yeah. You got all sorts of tricks there.
Oh, yeah.
Right there. He's like chewing on my hand.
And so you can monitor, hey, are we breathing? Sometimes they, even if they're not complete cardiac arrest, they might be breathing so shallow that we can't see their chest go up and down. So you can put your hand in front of their nose and mouth to see if you feel any airflow. Other things that if you happen to have a piece of Kleenex or something that would move easily with air, you can dangle it in front of the face as well, see if it moves. If that's not happening, next thing you want to do is you want to check for a pulse. And this is where a femoral you can try and feel the chest. And you find the heart on their chest, you take their leg, and you bend it. Where that elbow is on the chest, that's where the heart hangs out. So you can feel right here, and you can feel my hand, his heart is just fine. And if you have other big dogs, you can practice on those and just sort of let the leg down. Sometimes the heart's very quick, you may not be able to feel that. Or a quick thing is to feel the femoral force. Just on the inside of the leg, basically if you take your hand, start here, and rub it back right behind where we have the femur to be able to feel a heart bone. That's where the femoral force will be. You should be able to feel that. If you can do it. You feel that? That's why belly has some dogs.
We'll see how much you guys feel.